You're listening to The Lost Art of Liner Notes, a podcast by Rumbleyard. Recently, we caught up with Morgan Saint and her producer Cass Dillon and invited them to discuss making Morgan's new EP, 17 Hero. I could be looking for you, in all the wrong places. I could be missing on you, with all of this dreaming. I better chase this ghost before it leaves me. I can feel your warmth, my eyes go into hiding. I could be looking for you, in all the wrong places. Hi, I am Morgan Singh.
I'm Cass Dillon, and we made this record together.
Yes.
Yeah, so how did we meet? Where did that start from? I guess the North Fork.
I met Cass for the first time when he was playing at this restaurant, CJ's. In the same shopping center that my mom has her store. And Cass had released his own EP.
Mm-hmm.
And Stefano was there.
And we bought like 40 bales of hay.
Yeah, you did. And actually, they wanted to like...
We made like a stage out of
make
hay.
Make like a vibe. Yeah. It was literally in like the alleyway of the shopping center, which mm-hmm. is actually pretty cool.
It is cool.
And you guys, I think, borrowed a rug from my mom.
Oh, yeah, we did. Yeah, oh, yeah.
Because my mom's an interior designer and... She has a lot of rugs. Yeah, the hay, the cowboy boots. I was like, damn, this guy's like a cowboy. and I had long blonde hair. And
oh
I look nothing
God.
Like I look right now.
Yeah.
And remember Joe? This guy Joe who works for my mom. Yeah. He was like the warehouse manager.
He came around with moonshine.
He had like a bottle of like moonshine from like somewhere down south.
We met over moonshine, sort of.
Yeah.
So we made a little record together.
Yeah.
Let's talk about how we started that, how that all came together.
Yeah, I mean, I think working together, obviously I thought Cass was super talented as a singer-songwriter, and it was like refreshing to see, because he wasn't from Long Island, well,
like out
east,
there on the North Fork where you are.
From, and he happened to come out there to make this EP, which oddly enough is called Oregon Road, which is the road that my dad grew up on.
Crazy.
And
there are like a lot of serendipitous.
Yeah,
like,
we heard
cool,
so many weird things.
Strange,
actually, I think I met Stefano, our manager, first.
He met Danielle, your aunt.
Yeah,
somehow.
He met Danielle because I think you were doing some sort of thing through Pulse Magazine, which.
Right.
I used to help my mom with like advertisement and stuff.
Photos and all that.
And we advertise in Pulse Magazine. Danielle introduced us. Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
That feels like a really long time ago, but it wasn't that long ago.
I know. But then you sent me a song.
So I wrote a song. I was graduating from college and I had been writing a lot. I was working on my thesis project, which was called All the Ways, which mm-hmm. was like a really long-term project. And I had written like a poem a day for a year. And I was also writing music at the time. And I sent you a song called All the Ways that was inspired by...
It was so beautiful.
...my... thesis project, and I sent him a voice recording on my phone. And
but I mean, like for me, that was one of those moments where like just you, acoustic guitar, a vocal, crappy little iPhone recording, and I was like so excited. I was like, yes, aww. This is like such a beautiful like raw piece of music to like run with, you know. And I was like, this is gonna be like, I was like, well, Gideon, yeah, it was great.
Well,
it was a
so
great
then
moment.
I had like. Gotten some money for graduation. I was like, I want to put it towards something like that I could turn into. I love like having something to hold on to. My thesis project, I ultimately made part of it into like a book that I could hold on to. So I was like, I want to like really record a song, even if it's just this one song, just to like have done it and have it to hold on to. And we did. And that was where it all started. And then I fell in love with the process and I felt like I had learned so much being in the studio just for that one song. And I like was like hooked. So
We've kind of messed with like a few different areas of music until we like found your sound. Like,
yeah, but I feel like it happened pretty.
Oh yeah, like within like a month, you know. Yeah. But I mean, I think we started acoustically because
that's just how
just,
I had
like,
written.
Yeah, you were like playing at like vineyards, and you were like this like the sweetest little songwriter, like playing acoustic guitar, and it was just like, this is great. Let's take this and go with that. And then we're like, well, let's try something electronic because you were listening to a lot of that stuff. And I was like, hell yeah.
Well, I think I had always grown up listening to like a lot of acoustic, and that's how I write either on the piano or guitar.
Right,
so it made sense to start there. But then when I was writing, I approached it differently after that, as far as like...
Imagining where it could go.
Yeah, right. But it's interesting how I can approach it now, like already hearing how I imagine it. I can imagine like the world that I, like I want it to live in sonically before we even move into the studio.
Sure.
So
this record, you've talked about being like very conceptualized as far as like where the inspiration comes from and like the songs like telling a story. So is there like one song in particular that like really wraps up where the inspiration came from?
I think as far as the EP goes, Glass House, I think that song more than anything, when I was writing it, it was like I was having this weird moment where I was thinking about a like more romantic relationship that I was like dealing with. And then I was realizing how I'm like seeing patterns and trends in like my behavior and my relationships from like relationships from when I was growing up. And it was like, so I'm always wondering like, does this song make any sense to anybody? Because it makes so much sense in my head. But it was really like, whoa, like I'm seeing connections between things. And then I also think it was like a pivotal moment where I'm like, okay, well, I'm part of all these relationships. And if there's a trend, then maybe like there's certain things that I could change about the way I approach life. And
psychoanalyze yourself.
I don't know. I do some weird stuff, but so it was like really the one song that like just took like the past and the present and the future and like is in this one song.
And that song to me, that was like one of the trippiest experiences I ever had with like collaborating with someone, because I remember we were in a place where it was like you got signed and then we were like, we need tons of songs, and like we had just recorded a ton of songs, and then it was like, where are we gonna like pull from, you know, like the well has been like, you know, we've been like hitting it hard. So then something personal happened with me in a relationship in my life, and I was like, well, maybe I'll send you some like musical ideas and we'll like collaborate like that to help the writing process move forward. So I just went through like a the worst weekend ever. So heartbroken.
And I didn't know this until
you did not know. You had no idea.
Okay,
yeah.
So I sent Cass Glass House, which I had written, and we collaborated. So then that was like his part that he hadn't heard at all yet.
Right.
So melodically like lyrically. And so when I sent it to him, he loved it. And then we never talked about what it was about or anything. So it was funny because like I feel like less than a year later, but like all ways later, we were like eating dinner at my mom's house, and he was like, told me about, well, you can continue, but how you like had this weird connection to.
Well, yeah. So like, I was like going through something. So I threw my emotions into like this, like, you know, this little track idea. And then you sent it back with the melody and lyric over it. And like, I was like, what the fuck? You literally wrote what I just went through.
Yeah.
It was another, like, you know, a little iPhone recording over the little track. Yeah. And, like, I was just, like, in tears because I was like, it's just, like,
just a weird
totally
connection.
Wrapped up everything. Yeah. Shackled to the back of your head, boy. Hoping you will fall. Won't you love me now? Fucking love me now. It's all broken, unspoken. Just breathe me in, taste me on your lips. You can let me go if you need to let me go. Let's talk about maybe some other people that contributed to the record that, like, this record maybe really needed that extra little love, you know?
So to start, we've done some like strip tracks, and our friend Kim.
Yeah, Kim Vogels.
Kim Vogels, who's so amazing. Actually, I think I met her, like, was she playing the cello for you at that time?
Yeah. She was doing her own stuff. Mm-hmm. And then like we would like, you know, I'd play guitar for her and she'd play cello for me. And we would
So Cass is like, I think the music you make for yourself, the way I would describe it is like super feel good. Very relatable, definitely more like natural sounding, organic. And so every time you'd play, it was like so cool to watch because Kim would always like play with you and John would be playing the drums. So that's how I ended up meeting Kim through you. Mm-hmm. She was playing the cello.
Yeah.
And I just thought she was awesome. She's also a singer-songwriter.
Yeah, so she arranged the strings on the stripped
so
stuff.
So for the stripped stuff, she did the strings.
I thought she did such a beautiful job.
And then we have the EP.
We have Josh Barker and mm-hmm. Ethan Brewington, my mm-hmm. buddies down in Nashville.
Yeah, they contributed to Just Friends.
And yeah, they Josh's bass line, boom, 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 boom. And then, you know, when we just like went with that track and I was like, oh, that's super funky. Yeah. Let's keep going.
That's like so that.
And then now it's like the new single, you know, pretty cool. Mm-hmm. What are like weird things throughout this process happen? Like what, like, I feel like there's like always like a lot of like
tuna
like,
and a pancake.
Tuna and a pancake.
No, I'm just kidding.
That was kind of great though.
No, I mean, well, we work in Cass's studio, which is actually on Long Island. So I take mm-hmm. like the Long Island Railroad from Manhattan to him, which is a little bit of like a trip. So usually I'll stay over, then we'll just get a bunch of work done. And will you live in like a very specific,
like, industrial area. There's like we're above an auto body shop. And
yeah, so half the time we're like, oh, we can't do vocals because they're like drilling someone's car below us.
Rent is cheap and I can make music at any time of the day, at any time at night. So
yeah, and that's something that I can't do in my apartment because I get so many noise. My apartment's like ready to kick me out. Like, I'm moving.
Perfect timing.
But like, it's funny because I've lived in my apartment for like 4 or 5, probably 5 years now, and I'm finally moving, but, you know, obviously I like make music, so I'm like loud. I'll plug my guitar in, or I'll have my piano loud, or I'll literally like plug in a microphone to an amp and like sing. And like, I stay up kind of late, and my building's like a lot of older people. I've gotten so many noise complaints. They literally think I'm like the, and also when I was in school, I would be like spray painting in my apartment and they'd be like, what the hell? Like,
they just think
I'm like a delinquent. Like, they literally and when I'm not working, or like pretty much for the most part, like I probably look homeless. Like, I'm like in like big sweatpants and a sweatshirt and like no makeup, and like I have like this crazy hair, and they're just like, this girl is like literally nuts. And my mom came in to visit me, and she was like talking to my doorman, who like literally does not like me. Like, he will like open the door for other people and then will look at me with like 3 suitcases and just like watch me.
No way.
I think they literally just think I'm like a troublemaker. Right. But I'm not.
You're not. That's so funny.
So my mom was like, oh, I told your doorman all about what you're doing and I told him to watch you on Conan. And they probably are just like, what the hell? Like, it probably like all clicked to them.
Yeah.
But now he's like kind of nicer to me. So I'm moving now.
Because he wants those tickets.
So I'm happy to come to you and make a lot of noise and not feel like we're going to get any complaints. So.
Right.
Yeah. We were getting back to the story about the tuna and the pancake, which is probably not that interesting. So.
I know, but
it's so funny.
So we're in like the bagel place across the street from my studio. We always eat at like not like real like
normal hours.
It's like lunch is at like 3:30 and mm-hmm. dinner's like 10 o'clock if we remember to eat dinner, and it's like all over the place.
Yeah, so we were at the bagel place, and you were probably ordering something healthy, and I couldn't decide if I wanted like breakfast or lunch. And like, so I was like going in there, I was like, I'm just gonna get lunch. Like, I randomly started liking like tuna fish, which is really gross, but something about it on like a bagel.
No, that's amazing.
Actually, no, what happened is you told me to get the chicken salad, and I had ordered that one
chicken
time.
Chicken salad there,
and they gave
slamming.
Me the tuna instead, and I was like, "This is so good! It tastes like chicken salad."
Yeah, it kind of does. Yeah, it's like.
I just got that, but then when we walked in there, people were still eating breakfast. It was like a Sunday or something, probably, and it smelled so good. And I was like, "I just want pancakes too." So then,
you ordered the two things.
So I ordered specifically my tuna sandwich on a bagel And one, I asked her if she could make me one pancake.
Yeah.
So then we're like, so continue.
So then we're sitting there waiting and like, you know, we're, I don't know, sitting at the table, just, you know, killing the few minutes that we had while they were making the food.
And what did you get? And probably then, like egg whites with on a scooped out like.
Maybe something, probably exactly that. Anyway, so then we're sitting there and then all of a sudden we hear, tuna and a pancake.
And she had like a thick accent. Yeah, yeah. And we started like cracking up because it was just like.
Because it's like, I don't know. I never heard those people two were words just together like, before. Tuna
and a pancake. Yeah. Not like pancakes.
It almost sounded like you ordered like a pancake with a little tuna on top of it. Which is offensive.
And we started like laughing hysterically. And I feel like she thought we were like making fun of her accent or something. I felt so bad.
Yeah.
But it was still really funny.
But you told her that it was just.
Yeah, I was like, sorry. I just ordered really weird things and we're cracking up at.
This process, I almost feel like there were like different like phases and like stages, and there's like the beginning of us working together, then like once the label came in and we were making even more music and the EP, and then like finishing it with more songs and the album. Like, were there any periods for you where you were like worried or doubtful or like stressed, or did you ever have any?
Not really. I mean, I definitely think there's just a lot of like gray area as far as like when does this stuff need to be done by, like how many songs do we need to present for that?
Right.
And I'm just like, every song that I'm making, I really believe in, or we're not gonna
finish it. Or
like if I write something, I'm like that, I'm not that like, I don't really feel like this could really go somewhere. Mm-hmm. I just would like skip it.
Yeah.
But I guess since we weren't like. I wasn't sharing all those acoustic versions of the songs that I feel like people want to like listen to before you make music. I was just like, yeah, I'm just making like what I believe in. And yeah. I was set on those songs.
Which is so cool.
So I think it was like, you know, the idea of making more songs than you plan to use was like, felt like a waste to me. And I still feel like.
And also something that like wasn't really in like our schedule. It wasn't like we could like be just taking our time banging out like all these songs.
Yeah, like it was getting busy and. So that was a little stressful, but I felt like, you know, we collaborated on a few songs, which helped like time wise for me, because it's like, how many songs can you like just write fully on your
own? Most artists, I feel like, you know, are writing songs almost like, I mean, their whole life or like, you know,
or with or like at a least whole a long, bunch of people.
Yeah. And then there's like a process and you can go back and kind of pick like after like, you know, the last 5, 6, 7 years, you've been like really writing music and pull the best stuff.
Yeah.
But with you, is
I was
you
like were writing, only writing as for, we were going.
You started really writing your own first real songs like 2.5 years ago. Like
I mean,
I know you were always like writing, you know, but when you really took it seriously and were like, these are finished.
Yeah, exactly.
With melody and lyric and everything together. I know you've been writing poetry for like forever and making music or playing music forever, but like.
I think writing with the intention of it turning into something, that's different process.
Yeah.
And so I think once we released the EP and like gave Epic like that to run with, then we had a minute to like, I could go back to just like writing really intimately and connecting. And I feel like some of those songs are like my favorite just because I feel like it wasn't rushed and I could.
You can almost like, just, I don't know, maybe because I'm part of the process, I could like feel.
Yeah. Yeah, it's funny how your state of mind when you're writing that or like how it came together can affect your relationship with the song like long term.
Of course.
Isn't that weird?
I know, yeah. So tell me and whoever's listening out there, I don't know.
Mom. No, I'm just kidding.
Grandma. Who's like what's up next? What's going on?
That's always a good question. I'm never really sure what's going on like tomorrow, but I mean my hope and I think is that you know, obviously sooner than later we'll release the album. It's being
early summer-ish.
Yeah, I think early. I mean, maybe you guys would know better than me. I think early summer. We'll probably release like a single and then we'll release the album. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I don't know, lots of stuff.
Tours.
Yeah, touring. A lot of touring, I'm sure.
Playing a few festivals. We got this this West Coast tour with Missy.
Yeah, I think after we wrap that, I mean, I think time will tell, but I think we would love to reach like a point where we could just do like a headlining tour, you know, maybe towards the fall.
Yeah.
We'll see. Yeah. I guess we'll see how things go, but.
Of course.
Yeah, lots of exciting things. I mean, even outside of music, I think I never like to box myself in as just, you know, musical artist. I'm really involved with like
fashion
and mm-hmm. like the visual end of what I'm making. So I'm excited. Like, we have a new video coming out, mm-hmm. a bunch of exciting things.
Mm-hmm. So. Busy. Mm-hmm. Cool. So, this is awesome.
Yeah.
Thank you. You rule. Love you.
You rule. Love you too.
You're Morgan Saint.
You're Cass Dillon.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's what's up.
We are.
Huge thanks to Morgan Saint and Cass Dillon for being our guests. You can visit morgansaint.com to find out more about her new EP, 17 Hero, available now. This episode was produced by Lee Stimmel, Mark Grandy, Donna Shapiro, and me, Matthew Billy. Special thanks to Simon Marcus of Pippa and Epic Records. The Lost Art of Liner Notes is a Rumbleyard production. Rumbleyard is a division of Sony Music Entertainment. For more information, please visit rumbleyard.com. Thanks for listening.